About 1 in 4 Americans is infected with the human papillomavirus, often referred to as HPV. That's according to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. HPV happens to be the most common sexually transmitted infection in humans, and yet many Americans don't understand the severity of this type of infection. The CDC says that each year more than 42,000 HPV-associated cancers occur. The infection impacts women and men of all backgrounds. The Center for Community Health and Prevention at the University of Rochester Medical Center is hosting a viewing next month of the documentary film, Someone You Love, The HPV Epidemic. The screening will be followed by a panel discussion. The event is an effort to educate and enlighten our local community on HPV, in particular, its impact on cervical cancer. Joining me to begin this conversation prior to the May screening is Dr. Stanley Schaefer, associate professor in the Department of Pediatrics and at the Center for Community Health and Prevention at URMC. And Jason Coleman, senior manager of state and primary care systems for the American Cancer Society of Rochester. And welcome to you both. I appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
So the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention says that nearly all men and women, nearly all, will at some point get HPV in their lives. And I want to know, how is it that this virus can spread so easily? Dr. Schaefer, I'll start with you.
Well, you know, it is a virus that's very common, and particularly among young people, young adults. And in fact, you know, we're talking about approximately 1 out of every 4 people in the United States is infected with the HPV virus, about 79 or 80 million people. For most people, that viral infection will pass and will not cause any problems, but there's a small group in which the infection eventually will cause precancerous changes in the mucosa and eventually can cause different kinds of cancer. So, you know, prevention is really the key. That's what we really want to emphasize the most.
So in terms of, I mean, I guess how quickly can HPV spread? I mean, is this something, and then how often do you see? I mean, is it something that can be dormant for a period of time and pop up later? Is it something that relatively after intercourse you will notice that you have?
It's a silent infection, so you don't know that you have it. In the vast majority of cases. And it can be dormant for many, many years. So that is part of the problem. People aren't aware of it. They very well may have been infected and may have the virus for a number of years before it goes away or the changes occur. So again, prevention is where we want to put the most emphasis.
Right, and so in terms of prevention, let's talk a little bit about that. What does that look like?
So we have a goal of increasing vaccination rates to upwards of 80% by the year 2026. And that goal currently stands, we're at about 60% locally, but nationally closer to 50%. So we've got a long way to go. The target range for that vaccination is 11 and 12 year olds. And quite frankly, it has nothing to do with sex. We don't want parents to think that when their pediatrician brings it up that, right. that it's a sexual conversation. It's really a cancer prevention conversation. The body responds the best at that target age range. So the goal is to complete the series by the 13th birthday. So we have the ability to prevent 6 common types of cancer through vaccination. And unfortunately, there's a lot of parents out there that aren't taking advantage of this modern day opportunity to prevent cancer in a generation of adolescents.
Why do you think that parents aren't jumping on board with this?
Well, there's a lot of reasons. There's, you know, vaccines are heavily in the news these days. There's a large segment with a loud voice on social media with regard to vaccination. We want to encourage parents to seek out credible sources of information to make an informed decision for the health of their child. And that conversation begins with their pediatrician's office. The CDC has a great website, thecdc.gov. The American Cancer Society has great information at cancer.org, where parents can go to get information so that they're prepared to go into their pediatrician's office and ask the right questions. They're there anyway getting other vaccinations, so it's just a matter of preparing them with literacy around this issue, asking the right questions, and then getting the HPV vaccine at the same time their child's receiving other vaccinations.
So we'll revisit the prevention aspect in just a moment. But in terms of signs and symptoms of HPV, Dr. Schaefer, you said that this is a silent thing. So I guess, what are we looking for? What can we look for to know if there is an actual, if there's an issue?
Well, there's really very little you can do. In adult women, they can get their pap smears, and that's very important. But short of that, there's very little that they can do. When people go to the dentist may notice some precancerous lesions in the mouth, for instance, and usually that's due to HPV-related infections. So, you know, there are things like that. But again, you don't want to wait until you have an infection to deal with the problem, mm-hmm. because there's not much we can do once you have the infection to rid the body of it. So we want to prevent it as much as possible.
Mm-hmm. Well, in the documentary, Someone You Love, the HPV Epidemic, which will be screening at the Little Theater on May 2nd, the film takes audiences inside the lives of five women affected by HPV. One of those women is Kelly, and I'd like us to take a closer look at Kelly's story.
Kelly Pizzoli is a school teacher who is newly married to an officer in the U.S. Army. She was excited about her future until she was suddenly given a shock of a lifetime.
2.5 months ago, I had plans, you know, and I was, you know, moving back to St. Louis temporarily, like for the holidays to spend with my family, and then off to Chicago. I was going to coach trapeze again. And I was going to be living in a city that I love with the friends that I love. Literally 5 days before I was moving back to Chicago, I found out that I might have cancer. And so I didn't go to Chicago. I'm 31, living at home again with my dad. It's surreal. Now that I'm starting to not feel as wonderful, he's been really great. Like, he does so much for me.
She helps more than I help her. It's all her. It's all gymnastics, all gymnastic champions.
I was a really athletic kid, and I played volleyball and softball and basketball, and I was always a gymnast, and I was a swimmer for a while.
She never had dreams of the Olympics. It was just fun. She loved doing it, she really did. She was good, too. I shouldn't brag, but she was good, obviously. I was there, too, on 3 or 4 nights a week sometimes. Right after school, she'd come home, do her homework, and get ready. We'd go to the gym, stay there for 3 or 4 hours.
In 2005, I got into trapeze, and I love it. And that's what I want to be doing right now. I don't know that I'll ever live in Chicago again, and I don't know that I'll have the opportunity to coach trapeze. I was getting my pap smears regularly. I had had a doctor inside me with a speculum 3 times in the year preceding my diagnosis, and she didn't see it. It's scary. I was doing all the right things, and I was, you know, going to the doctor as I should and getting all the screenings and doing all of that to the T. And then all of a sudden I have a 4.6 centimeter tumor hanging into my vagina. And yeah, okay, I have HPV, but that's gonna go away. Because I had cleared it once before. It was back, and I was like, okay, well, I'm gonna clear it like I did before. And then I went in for a follow-up, and it wasn't okay.
She knows everything about what's wrong with her. She speaks to the doctors on a one-on-one basis. She knows the terminology.
Unfortunately, in Kelly's case, it appears to be aggressive and rapidly growing just based on what we're seeing. Apparently, it was not there 3 months ago. Now it is.
It doesn't make any sense. Like, I was literally laying on the table flabbergasted when this doctor said that she saw a mass on my cervix. Like, what? No, there's no way. It's not cancer, because cancer doesn't grow that fast. Well, it was cancer.
How common is Kelly's story? She said she had, you know, been to the OBGYN regularly, tested for, you know, got her pap smears, and yet she was totally shocked when she found out about cancer. Is that something that is typical her story? Is it more of a rarity?
Unfortunately, that's very common as a presentation of cervical cancer or vaginal or vulvar cancer in women. Again, this is a cancer that seems to target young adult women in particular, and so those are the people that we, you know, we really want to focus on the most. Again, getting pap smears are very important for young women. So yes, that is the group.
So in terms of prevention, it sounds like, I guess, when should women begin screening for this? When do we start testing for this?
So pap smears are recommended to begin at age 21. When women turn 30, they're encouraged to get co-testing. At that age, they'll begin testing for the HPV virus with the same sample they would gather for their pap smear. So it's a very simple request, but we encourage women to ask for that co-testing beginning at age 30.
And then in terms of the vaccine, I want to go back to that. At what point, you mentioned 11, 12, you know, this is when young people should be getting this vaccine. At what point do we age out of getting it? When is there a point when you're just too old?
So initially the indication for the vaccine was as young as age 9 and up through age 26. Recently that has been increased to age 45. But we still encourage the body responds much better at a younger age before exposure takes place.
Are there other myths and misconceptions in relation to HPV that might be causing people not to get testing, that might be causing people not to get the vaccine that you want to address and that you think people should be aware of?
So there's another story in the movie that I think is very compelling, and that's the story of a patient named Susie. And Susie was abstinent until she was married. And she hadn't been vaccinated. She was exposed to HPV with her very first partner. So for the parents that say, my child doesn't need that vaccine because they're not active, that's not the rationale to take. You need to look at this as pure and simple cancer prevention. We have the ability to prevent cancer through vaccination, targeting them before age 13 in a two-shot series to prevent stories like Kelly's and Susie's and Tamika's. It's a very simple step that parents can do today. And we encourage them all to take advantage of that opportunity.
Unfortunately, we are out of time. We will close for now, but a special thank you to my guests for really breaking down this issue for us. Please be sure to save the date for the screening of the documentary film, Someone You Love, The HPV Epidemic, plus the panel discussion following that film. It's taking place on Thursday, May 2nd from 6 to 8 p.m. at the Little Theater. The event is brought to you by the Center for Community Health and Prevention at the University of Rochester Medical Center. To register for the event, go to lecture.urmc.edu/HPV.